Welcome to Discovering. Macintosh, Jonathan, Cortland, Honeycrisp, it's apple picking time. On my recent trip to Wisconsin, I stopped in at Pleasantview Orchard and Bakery, where you can buy them over the counter, pick your own, or get them in a pie.
We decided we needed something active, and Hal would like to have do an orchard.
We planted trees every year for about 5 years, and now we're set at around 2,000 trees.
And I said, if you're going to do an orchard, I want a bakery.
Sit back and relax. It's Monday night and time for Discovery.
The secret streams that flow beneath the cliffs of colored stone. Forests thick and healthy with birch and pine and oak. Surrounded by the greatest lakes this world has ever known. Black Bear's awesome presence as he roams the hills and fields. Call of the timber wolf, the loon's lonesome trill. The eagle soaring high above, the trout lies deep and still. These are what I treasure, the only way I measure. Feelings that I have for this fine land. There is so much to discover when you're a longtime lover of northern Michigan.
Just across the Menominee River into Wisconsin, on a quiet backcountry road, you'll find Pleasantview Orchard and Bakery. When you stop in here, you'll most likely be greeted by Stanley.
He's our orchard cat. He loves company. And all the kids come and they love him. Hi there, are you coming to pick some apples?
Before you can say here, kitty kitty, the wonderful smell of fresh apple pie will lead you into Carol's Bakery. Apple pie made from apples grown in the orchard right outside the door. We'll be back to check on the baker before long, I assure you. First, it's a trip to the orchard where I met up with Hal and found out just how little I knew about growing apples.
Back in my late 50s, I was looking ahead and wondering what's our retirement going to be like. And I wanted an active retirement.
6 years before we wanted to retire, we discussed the fact that we heard the motto, you rest, you rust. Or if you don't use it, you lose it. So we decided we needed something active.
Came out here in December with a shovel, dug through the snow, got a soil sample, and had it tested, and lo and behold, it came out ideal for growing fruit. So we made the purchase, and the following spring, 2002, we planted 180 trees.
The winter of 2002 was one of the worst on record, where it froze like 6 feet deep.
I came out here in the spring thinking all my trees would be dead. Quite the contrary, they were all alive. And I said to my wife, how about if we start an orchard?
And I said, if you're going to do an orchard, I want a bakery. And we both kind of chuckled at each other thinking, yeah, right, this is not going to happen.
And then we planted trees every year for about 5 years. And now we're set at around 2,000 trees.
I told him 2,000 is probably the limit. Please don't plant anymore.
Right now our orchard's about 40% Honeycrisp, obviously because it's a very popular apple. We've got some new varieties like Honeycrisp and a lot of the old-time favorites like Macintosh, Cortland, Wealthy. In addition to that, I've got Zestar, which is a newer apple. That's proving to be really popular, and people will buy that before the Honeycrisp come in. We've got another new variety, Red Free, the earliest one. We've got Liberty, which is a disease-resistant tree. Sweet 16, I've just added more Sweet 16s. That's a very unusual apple. It's a very interesting flavor. Snow Sweet, that's a late apple. A lot of calls for that. I'm going to have to plant some more of those. Some people are looking for a very tart apple, and that's Crimson Crisp. Deep red apple, very firm, crunchy, juicy. That ripens about the middle of October. Another good variety is Macowan. Not many people know about it. That's actually one of the parents of the Honeycrisp. It's one of my favorites, similar to a Macintosh, only better flavor, longer shelf life. Most people don't understand this. They think that if you take a Honeycrisp apple, take the seeds out, plant it in the ground, and they'll wait for the tree to grow, which it will, and they expect Honeycrisp to fruit. Well, that's not how it works. Apples have to be cross-pollinated. They need pollen from a different variety. So that Honeycrisp tree may have been pollinated by a Macintosh, and when you get the mix of genetics, you'll get something entirely different. And there could be, you know, 200,000 different varieties that could come out of that. So in fact, most of those trees, most of the fruit that comes from those plantings, the fruit will not taste good. Many of the characteristics of the apple tree and the fruit come from the rootstock. Things such as disease resistance and, of course, the size of the tree. What we use here primarily is a rootstock called Bud 9, or Budogofsky 9 is short for that. And that rootstock was developed in the cold climates of Russia. So it works out very well for this climate right here. So when I graft, I get that rootstock, and when I buy trees from a nursery, I specify Bud 9 rootstock. So that gives me the dwarfing, and that gives me the characteristics that I want for this climate. It's the only way you get a true strain of an apple is to take a branch from that particular tree and graft it onto the rootstock. You can even graft multiple branches from different trees. I had some Fujis, and turns out Fujis did not do well in this climate. I took them all out. I left one tree, and on that I grafted 10 different apples from 10 different trees, grafted the branches from them. So in a couple of years, and I was getting 10 different kinds of fruit onto a Fuji tree, which is kind of interesting and colorful. So these were planted this year. And if you notice down here, when you plant a tree, you've got to keep the soil line below the graft union. That little knob there is the graft union. If you get that graft union down into the soil, it will start to root and develop roots off this stem. And it will revert back to a standard tree. And of course, we want the dwarfing of the roots. This is a prolific tree. We planted them this year, and I probably had, out of 40 trees, probably had about a bushel of fruit come off here. I would get anywhere from 1 to 7 or 8 apples on here, and I would thin them down to 2 or 3. I didn't want to stress that plant too much. Crop load is very important in the management of an apple orchard. In the spring, with a good bloom, and we had a wonderful bloom this past year, lots of flowers, lots and lots of flowers. And if you have good pollination, which we did, you're going to get an enormous crop load. Every flower bud will produce up to 5 apples. And if every one of those was pollinated, and if you did nothing with it, your apples would be very, very small, and you probably would not be a happy camper. So what we do, what all apple growers do in the spring, is thin their crop load. We use two methods. One is we put a chemical on which stresses the tree, and it will drop the weaker fruit. You can only use that method up to 25 millimeters in diameter, about like that. You've got to be careful, because it's possible that you could drop all your fruit and have nothing in the fall. So how many fruit do you want to leave on the tree? Well, it depends on the size of the tree. And what we do is measure the diameter of the trunk. at about 1 to 2 feet from the ground, take the cross-sectional area, pi r squared times 5. For this size stem here, it's around 100 apples. What we have to do is we have to go through and physically pick off apples on trees that have too many. Rule of thumb is you don't want apples closer. You want them about 8 inches apart on a branch. So if you do that, you'll get good size apples. They'll color up better, as this tree is doing. For dwarf orchards, it's mandatory that you have irrigation. And what I use is drip irrigation. Each row of trees has this plastic drip line. Every 2 feet, it's got a little opening with a device inside. It's called a pressure compensating emitter. This line will fill up with water. The hole on this end will produce the same amount of water as the hole 200 feet down the line. Pest management is very important to the apple grower. There are 6-8 different pests that we have to worry about. And I use what's called integrated pest management. We do our best to minimize the pesticides and fungicides we put on the tree. One of the most critical pests is called the codling moth. The codling moth flies about at the end of June into July, and it will lay its eggs either on the apple or on the leaves. And when the eggs hatch into larvae, they will find an apple and tunnel directly into the core of the apple and pupate there. What we do is we put traps out in the orchard. If I catch 5 moths in that trap in a period of 1 week, I know the population is high enough where it warrants putting a pesticide out. We keep track of degree days, which is measures the heat in the orchard. And when 250 degree days are attained from the time I caught that moth, that's the time that the eggs are hatching, and that's when we put the spray on. Now, also interesting is that I no longer spray for codling moth. And the reason is that this device right here, this is a device that's impregnated with a pheromone, female sex hormone. I've got 1,200 of these scattered throughout the orchard, and this puts that female scent out in the orchard. So the orchard's flooded with this scent. The male can't find the female. There's so much scent in the orchard that he can't find that female, and they can't mate, so she can't lay eggs. And as a result, we have no problem with the codling moth. Since I started using these, I have not had to spray once for codling moth. The other critical pest is called the apple maggot, and we use 2 different devices to trap for the apple maggot. And the adult form is looks like a housefly about 1/3 the size, and it's got special markings on the wings, and it has a white dot on the back of its head. That pest will lay that egg, and when it hatches, it makes those tunnels through the apple. The day that I find apple maggot on my trap, I have to spray within a day or two. This is a trap that will catch the insects, and this little rubber cylinder here is impregnated with the female pheromone of that particular insect. Now, this particular trap with that pheromone is the pheromone from the red-banded leaf roller. It's an insect that will start chewing on the leaves and then roll it up and create like a little cocoon on it. When the males are out for that particular insect, they're attracted to that smell. They come in here, they will land on there and get caught, and it allows me to once a week go in here and count that insect. And again, if it reaches the threshold, you know that you're going to have a problem with it. It's very important that you have tree guards around the base of your tree to protect from rodents. If you get a year with a lot of snow, you get rabbits in here, they can reach above this easily and start gnawing on the lower branches. So what I've done now, I've gone to a 2-foot hardware cloth. It's called with 1/4-inch holes in it. That works much better, but you still have to be worried about rabbits because they love that these young branches, and they will even chew on the stem of the apple tree. So when I see rabbit tracks, I'm out here with my rabbit trap, and I'll catch them. They don't taste too bad either.
This is Hans. He's a German-made wheat grinder, and he grinds my wheat for me for my breads and my pastries. When you buy my product, you don't have to worry. There's no vitamins needed because you're getting the entire full kernel of grain. Good boy, you started right up. Boy, he can grind enough wheat in 15 minutes for 8 2-pound loaves of bread. And because it's fresh ground, the bread rises beautifully. There is no, it's all wheat flour. This is Goliath. It's not work for me. I love doing this. Real fruit. It's not that artificial candied fruit. Try not to get it on the filling because then it gets a little gooey.
Okay, the apple filling is 3 different types of apples that we grow here. Macintosh, Cortland, and Wellesley. And then the raspberries. I do have to buy the raspberry for the pie pocket filling because I can never pick enough from my patch. So, but they're delicious.
Combination of Wellesley's, Cortland's, and Macintosh.
Everything we do here basically is from our orchard. All the jams and everything. We have apricot trees, so I do have apricot jam. However, our apricot trees only bloom like every third year due to our cold springs. This year, our apple crop is amazing. It's probably the best we've ever had. Well, it is the best we've ever had.
Our apple season runs from about Labor Day to middle of October. Our first apple that ripens is the Red Free. That's a beautiful apple. Nice red color, nice and firm. So that's followed by Zestar and Ginger Gold, Honeycrisp, Macintosh, Cortland. That takes us into October. And the last one to ripen would be the Crimson Crisp and the Snow Sweet. So we got a span. They don't all, of course, don't all ripen all at the same time, which is nice for us as a producer because it spreads our work out. Now the question is, how do you know when an apple is ripe? There's probably three different things that we watch for. There's a fore color and there's a back color. The fore color is red. When the back color turns from green and starts going to gold or orange, that tells me that apple is getting close to becoming ripe. Step number 2 is to open up to the core of the apple and look at the seeds. As the apple is developing, the seeds will be white. And as it's approaching maturity, that color will change from white gradually to brown to dark brown. When that seed is dark brown, that's the second indicator that apple is ripe. And the third indicator is taste. If it's not ripe, it'll taste starchy. You know, if you've ever eaten a raw potato, you know what a starchy flavor is. That's the final check. How does it taste to you? Well, if they want them on the tart side, you pick them just before their optimum maturity window. If they like them sweet, well, you let them hang until that window is there. If you want to be real specific about it, there's probably only a 2 to 3 day window where it's at its optimum, but obviously you could go a week before that and even 2 weeks after that where it's, the apple is in good shape. Some apples store better than others. Typically, your early apples do not have a long shelf life. Yellow transparents, their window is very small. You got about a 2 or 3 day picking window, and within a week, that apple is so soft you wouldn't want to eat it. Zestar has a shelf life of about 7 weeks in proper refrigeration. The Honeycrisp, you can go 7 months. Often we will be eating our Honeycrisp into April and even May. Most apples should be stored down to about as close to freezing as you can, 33 degrees or so. And you want to put them in a cooler that has no other produce in it. All produce gives off ethylene, and ethylene will age apples. If you're going to store Honeycrisp, the experts say hold them at 55 degrees for 1 week and then put them in cold storage at 38 degrees. For all the other varieties, you're down to about 33, 34. They say put the Honeycrisp at 38. So if you're able to do that, that's the best way to store the Honeycrisp.
Well, that's it for tonight. If you'd like to keep tabs on what's coming up on Discovering or see where we've been, you can join us on Facebook or go to 906outdoors.com. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week right here on Discovering.